Well, it's always a pleasure to welcome this next guest to Robin Hood Radio. That is Christine Gefford, Crescendo. They have another event coming up very quickly, as a matter of fact, on Friday, April 8th at 6 p.m. at Trinity Church in Lime Rock, and then again on Saturday, April 9th at 4 p.m. at the beautiful St. James Place in Great Barrington. And this is your first in a series of four concerts of vocal and instrumental music, right?
Correct. We are really happy that we can start live performances up again after 5 months of a hiatus that we all had, including our audiences, of course. So yes, this is a chamber music concert with a twist, as we call it, where we present Baroque music, which is to be expected of Crescendo, but also Latin American music. And we want to show the connection between folk and classical music and between early music and modern and contemporary music. We think so much in boxes. I include myself. We're so compartmentalized. So we think we belong here, we belong there, certain type of people, certain type of music. And this concert is a little bit a show of, you know what, there are really, these things are mostly in our minds. There's only good and interesting music and perhaps not so interesting music in any style. But the truth is that all of our folk popular music throughout the ages is so connected. And dance is, of course, something that we don't associate so much with a chamber music concert. And while we will not dance or have dancers for this particular concert, maybe in the future, dance rhythms and patterns, we will show those, and you will hear them in the music of Johann Sebastian Bach and Georg Philipp Telemann, who literally wrote a whole concerto called Concerto Polonaise in the style of the Polish folk music. And Bach is represented with two big pieces that feature the Polish style with these lively rhythms that were danced. Maybe it's not so known, Bach worked for an emperor who was also emperor to the Polish territories. So he catered to that taste too. And in those times, yes, the folk music was an integral part of so-called classical music. So that's already interesting. And then what is also interesting, that the European traditions came to Latin America and informed the new music, both and mixed with the African cultures, with the indigenous cultures and their music and rhythms. And of course, we know that the rhythms were so lively and interesting. So for instance, our violinist Job, who is Mexican, in his homeland was a leading young violinist in a symphony orchestra, and at the same time he was playing in mariachi bands. And so was Carlos Voltes, our viola and charango player in Chile. He played in a very famous Andean folk ensemble called Barroco Andino, which became world famous. So he played folk music with them. And then he studied classical viola and became a soloist did a master in viola here in the United States as well, and then stayed here. So they are both from both worlds. I myself as well, growing up in Chile, I was part of a guitar band, a folklore band, and we did more melodic folk, Latin American folk. And then, of course, I have all of my classical training inside in the keyboards and in the choral music. So I grew up there too and had my fair share of experience with folk music. And so, yes, you will hear in this concert mariachi tunes, and we will improvise on the basis of these four different tunes, and we will show improvise in the Baroque way. And then we will segue into the mariachi tune. It will be very obvious. And it will also be very obvious how connected both are, because we found those bass lines are literally the standard Baroque bass lines for dances, suites, and other movements that are known to the Baroque connoisseurs. So, and we're also going to do a couple of pieces that have been very recently arranged and written for our ensemble, a composer from Puerto Rico, another composer from Argentina. And so we have a couple of pieces that are based on folk tunes, but are contemporary music written for us. And it's an unusual combination. I play an instrument called the virginal. It's from the family of the harpsichords. And it is a particular virginal. In a virginal, the strings go lengthwise, and the keyboard is this way. Normally, in a harpsichord, and an S in the piano, the strings obviously go away from the keyboard, and here they are lengthwise in front of me. And this particular instrument is a pentagonal virginal. It has five sides built and commissioned during the first pandemic year by the famous and fantastic builder here locally in Norfolk, Carl Dudash, for me. So this is one of the first few concerts that I'm bringing this instrument out. And in the folk music, it takes a little bit the part of a harp. The harp was very popular is still in Latin American countries to play folk music and accompany music. And Hop will also play bombo and percussion besides violin. So bombo is the big Latin American drum. And Carlos Voltes is known to our audiences. He's, as I was saying, a master in viola, a viola player. And as well, he plays the charango, which is a very small instrument with a long neck and a double set of strings, which was particular to the Andean cultures of Latin America during the colonial times. So this concert is we titled it Mientras Me Abraza, after the name of one of the zambas, the Argentinian samba, the piece that was written for our ensemble, arranged. It means while she hugs me. So it's a very popular tune.
We're talking with Christine Gebert once again, Crescendo, back in action with, yes, concerts you can actually attend, Friday, April 8th at 6 p.m. at the Trinity Church in Lime Rock, and then on Saturday, April 9th at 4 p.m. at St. James Place in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. And once again, if you want more information or tickets, the website is crescendomusic.org, crescendomusic.org. How long does it take for you to put together a program like this? Seeing as this program, all your programs are diverse, but this one appears to be even more diverse.
Well, this is in the makes for many, many months. I would say probably we started working on this last year in October. So this has been coming for a long time, this program, and it has evolved. We've tried components of it. And we, in all honesty, because this is also partly improvised, we work till the very last minute. And something curious, so this is a long in the makes. It takes a long, long time. What the pandemic has done to us all, that we've had to find ways to rehearse remotely, the silver lining is that with our colleagues now, we are able to take more time. Because we literally have remote rehearsals, and there are now apps that permit musicians to make music together in real time. Zoom or these meetings that we're having, like a Zoom meeting, they have a delay that for a conversation is completely fine. But if you and I were going to start to sing now, we would be out of sync. I don't know if you want to sing, but even if we would clap, we would go one, two, three, clap, our clap would be like that. And so you cannot actually rehearse on Zoom. But there are these apps out, and so we've been able to learn these and acquire a little bit of equipment. I have several microphones now in my studio up here, and we've all acquired equipment and knowledge. And that's the silver lining of the pandemic, and that is here to stay and bring us closer, open doors, and make things possible that we were not thinking of before. We had to travel to Boston or to the Hartford area where Carlos Voltes is from, And the logistics of that are, of course, challenging. So now we have been able to evolve a program like this for a much longer time with remote rehearsals.
Well, you know, it's the same thing with the radio station. Like I said, I've always had a studio at home, but it's never been a studio that I could do a studio quality interviews with from home. And Zoom allows me that ability to do that. And so then we can actually reach more people. I want to go on one thing here, Christine. Let's talk about COVID, because there are some people out there that are still wary. But
yes.
I'm looking at your website and what you've posted, your COVID protocol for your concerts and events, which you updated on March 14th, really shows the safety that you've set up for the people that come.
Yes, we have high level of safety, and not only we require from our audience members to show their vaccination card and to be masked, we also in the venues have, in both venues, forced airflow, which is actually rarer than you would think after 2 years of the pandemic, which is an airflow that does not recycle the air. Of course, St. James Place is a very modern venue with a wonderful air system, and a Trinity Church is one of the few places actually in our area that has this in place, assisted by the technicians, carefully put in place. Crescendo also invested in purchasing 7 portable air purifiers last year when Omicron came on the scene. And these are running and doing an extra layer of protection during rehearsals as well for our performers, but certainly when the audience are there. And believe me, these air purifiers, they're completely silent. They have been tested also in the lab, and so they are effective catching the COVID virus. So they are really high tech. And so the whole board was behind this decision to invest the money also for the future, even for flu season in the future, and whatever else is thrown at us. Also, at this point, we are masking as performers. We are also testing. So this is not all laid out at the website. We don't want to overwhelm everybody, but not only do we ask this from the audiences so everybody feels safe, but we as performers do testing for several days, and we wear masks. It's possible that some of these concerts, when we... the most safe ways possible. So we're very, very at the cautious side of the COVID policy. And our performers are boosters required. The audience member is required to be vaccinated, but all of our performers have to have their booster shots.
Right.
So,
well,
yes.
Once again, it's great to have the live events back with Crescendo. Once again, Friday, April 8th at 6 p.m., Trinity Church in Lime Rock. And then on Saturday, April 9th, 4 p.m., St. James Place in Great Barrington. Once again, the website is crescendomusic.org for music, and they can get tickets there too. Are tickets available at the door as well?
Yes, there will be tickets available at the door always. Yeah, we keep a contingent of tickets. So yes, people can come. The doors open 3/4 of an hour before. And also save the dates. We have 3 more concerts. It's unusual. Yeah, you might have seen in the news, or perhaps you missed it, that we also got 2 grants from the state of Connecticut. These were monies, special monies made available to us by the Connecticut Humanities and the Connecticut because of this support that we've gotten from the state of Connecticut. So this is wonderful. So therefore, save the dates. There is a very exciting concert coming up in another month with works by Italian 17th century composer Giacomo Carissimi. And there is one of the earliest, if not the earliest, oratorio on a very dramatic story of Jephthah. It's a fantastic piece with six-voice choir with soloists from Boston and New York City and Rochester, New York. We have a great cast, crescendo vocal ensemble and period instruments. We have another chamber music concert in June where we will go into double keyboard pieces, dialogue, two keyboards in dialogue plus theorbo and lute. And we will also improvise. It's going to be challenge each other to improvise and respond on the spot. There are some works like that that only write out the bass. So we're having a lot of fun preparing that repertoire, and I think the audiences will love this. There will be two virginals on stage. And then to finish this this 2022 spring, early summer series, at the end of June, a concert with music by so-called the Brazilian Mozart. We call it Grandson of Slaves, which he was. He was a mulatto composer who lived in Brazil during the times of Mozart, and was a stellar composer. Another example of a forgotten composer that nobody had paid attention, and now even more important, as everybody is aware now, the Black Lives Matter movement happened also in 2020, of course, and made us all sorely aware of our bias and of our blindness. And we musicians and artistic people and performers are nowhere exempt of this. So both of our education and our just simple cultural bias has also prevented us from programming music by Black composers, researching, being interested in, and so forth. So with Crescendo, we're doing baby steps to remedy this. And this is one of these steps. Mauricio Garcia Nunes is the name of the composer. And we also are hiring some wonderful Black soloists from the Hartford area, with whom I had collaborated. We had collaborated a bit, but they really, really deserve to be featured in a special way, because there should be more opportunities now. We're in such a wide area. So I hope people look forward to this and join us in this journey to explore something. This repertoire is really fantastic. It is like Mozart, but then it's its own thing. It's got its own language as well. Something very curious. One of the big pieces is written for organ with cello and bass, and two bassoons. You normally know two violins or two flutes or two oboes or something like that, melody instruments, trumpets, but no, this is for organ and two bassoons, who get a lot of interesting melodic lines. And then it has solo parts and choral parts. And in part, this also blows your mind. It's a sacred piece, but it sounds like a light opera chorus. It's very own thing. It's very fun. Like one of the professional musicians, when I sent the score out, she said, "This is like the antidote to Bach." And I had to laugh out loud, because it's true. It's in a way absolutely not serious in at times, in a very good way. So I hope you all are becoming a little curious about what we have to offer. It's certainly something that you're not hearing necessarily in this area right now. So don't miss these concerts. I also come out to support musicians and performers. We need you. We need the live audiences. We do everything we can to make you safe and to present something really interesting, but we need people to come back. It's really very crucial. And if you're a little bit on the fence and say, "I'm not sure, and I don't know if this is for me," give it one try. I promise that you will take something home that is exciting. And if not, you write a note to me and we'll see what we can do. But yeah, do come.
All right, Christine, thank you very much for joining us. And Good luck with these upcoming concerts on the 8th and also the 9th, but also the rest of the year, spring and early summer season. And I know we've got more coming after that.
Thank you.